Hi, I'm Alex with Splunk Education. You may already be familiar with how to create alerts in Splunk to let you know when something in your environment needs your attention. In this video, we'll learn how to use alert actions in response to trigger conditions to make those alerts even more powerful. While alerts can search for events on a schedule or in real time, they don't have to trigger every time search results appear. Trigger conditions help you monitor patterns in event data or prioritize certain events. Trigger conditions work as a secondary search to evaluate the alert's initial search results. When the secondary search generates results, the alert then triggers. Alert actions are there to help you respond to triggered alerts. When an alert triggers, we can choose to add it to a list of triggered alerts, log an event to an index, output the results to a CSV lookup file, output the results to a telemetry endpoint, send an email, send a notification to Splunk Mobile, or use a webhook. The script alert action is deprecated. As an alternative, admins can also define custom alert actions, which can include scripts. We will be taking a closer look at the three most common options, starting with output results to a lookup. Our security team would like a daily list of potential tailgaters, or people who accessed our network but did not badge into the building. Let's begin by running a search that queries both our network data and badge reader data. Then, using the eval command, we create a field to determine whether a user badged in. Using stats and where, we will filter out those users who did not, leaving us with a list of users who connected to the network and did not badge into the building. Now that we have our results, let's click Save As and choose Alert. We will begin by naming the alert, selecting the permissions, and setting the alert type. We need a daily list of offenders, so we select Scheduled and Run Every Day at Midnight. Since the alert will run every day at midnight, we can leave the expiration as 24 hours. For trigger conditions, we will leave it as Number of Results is greater than 0. The throttle option will allow us to suppress alert triggering for a specific time period. Sometimes alerts can trigger frequently because of similar search results or scheduling. Since our alert is only running once per day, we do not need to throttle the alert. Under Add Actions, we select Output Results to Lookup. We can choose to write to an existing lookup or create a new one. We will enter a new lookup name. Then, depending on the type of results you need, you can have the alert append the new values to an existing lookup or replace them completely when the alert triggers. We only need to see the daily offenders, so we will select Replace and save the alert. When the alert triggers, we will see the new file located in Settings, under Lookups, and selecting Lookup Table Files. Once the lookup file exists, we can create a lookup definition for it, so we can reference the lookup when searching. Let's navigate back to Settings and select Add New next to Lookup Definition. We will save this definition in the Search and Reporting app, give it a name, select the type, and choose the table file. After saving our new lookup definition, the security team can now use the lookup created by the alert in their searches. Since there is a potential on some days we will have no tailgaters, let's edit our existing alert to include one more alert action. We click Edit next to Potential Tailgaters. Scrolling down to the bottom, let's click Add Action once more and select Send Email. We fill out the To field with a comma-separated list of email addresses and optional CC and BCC fields. Then we select the priority and can customize the default subject. With certain alert actions, like send email or log event, you can utilize tokens to make your result more dynamic. Tokens work as placeholders or variables for data values that populate when the search completes. We will use a few different token options with our alerts, but there are many more options available. By default, we see a token of name, which will populate with the name of the alert when the email is sent. Next, under the message field, we can customize the body of the email. Now we can choose what we would like to include in our email. We can link users to the alert or to the results, include the search string, trigger condition, and trigger time of the alert. We can display the results as an inline table, a list of raw events, or in a CSV file format, or include a file attachment in the form of a CSV or PDF. And lastly, allow empty attachment would still include a CSV or PDF attachment with the email, even if the associated search has not returned results. We will select Attach CSV. We will leave the type as HTML and plain text and save our alert. Now our security team will receive a notification via email when they have results to investigate. The last type of alert action we will explore is log event. When we select log event and an alert is triggered, events are sent to your Splunk deployment for indexing. Using the log event alert action will require an admin role or the edit TCP capability. Our boss would like to be able to use Splunk, but doesn't want to search through too much data. Lately, he has been very aggressive against web server errors and would like simplified data he can search. We can provide that to him by indexing just the data he needs from an alert and putting it into an index just for him. He is only interested in data where a server error occurred, so we will write a simple search looking for qualifying events. Click Save As and choose Alert. We will give the alert a title and select an alert type of real time to search continuously. Since we want to log all events, we will select to trigger per result and not throttle it. Now we will select Log Event as the trigger action. We would like Splunk to automatically extract fields from events created when they are indexed, so we use key value pairs. In the event field, we add a field of status. Using a token of result will return a specified field from the first search results row. We use it with status so that the status value from our first search results populates this token. Next, we create a field value pair that will return the host field from the results. Finally, we create a field that will be populated with data of the date the alert was triggered and the time it was triggered. We can customize values for the source, source type, host, and index for the events that will be generated. We are able to use tokens for these fields as well. By default, the source will be named alert, followed by the alert token. The token will populate with the name of the alert. Let's change the source type to a new name specific to these events. The host field will default to the IP address of the host of the alert. We will customize ours using a token. We will set it to server, followed by a token that will return the name of the server hosting our Splunk deployment. Finally, we choose which index to log the events to, and click Save. Now, when an alert is triggered, redefined details of the events will be indexed and are searchable. And since we used key value pairs in the event field, Splunk can extract them at search time, giving our boss the best of both worlds.
Thanks for joining us to learn more about advanced alert actions. To continue your journey learning about Splunk, we suggest you check out the documentation, watch additional videos on the Splunk How-To channel, and register for courses from Splunk Education. Thanks for watching.